Hello, I'm Dr. Bridget Nash, and I'd like to welcome you to The Therapy Show, a podcast series that seeks to explain the leading forms of psychological therapy in a way that is understandable to everyone. Today, I'm honored to welcome Dr. Ursula Whiteside, who is a licensed clinical psychologist and a member of the clinical faculty at the University of Washington. She is here to discuss the topic of suicidal behavior. Dr. Whiteside trained under Dr. Marsha Linehan, the creator of dialectical behavioral therapy, and later served as a DBT adherent research therapist on a clinical trial led by Dr. Linehan that was funded by the National Institute of Mental Health. As a researcher, she has been awarded grants from the National Institute of Mental Health and the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. Dr. Whiteside is the CEO of NowMattersNow.org, which was conceived from her research study involving over 18,000 high-risk suicidal patients in four major health systems. This study includes a guided version of NowMattersNow.org, which is a program she developed that includes skills for managing suicidal thoughts and is based on DBT and paired with lived experience stories. Dr. Whiteside is national faculty for the Zero Suicide Initiative, a practical approach to suicide prevention in healthcare and in behavioral healthcare systems. Dr. Whiteside serves on the faculty of the National Action Alliance Zero Suicide Academy. She is also a founding board member of the United Suicide Survivors International and a member of the Standards, Training, and Practices Committee for the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline. As a person with lived experience, she strives to decrease the gap between us and them and to ensure that the voices of those who have been there are included in all relevant conversations. Nothing about us without us. Dr. Whiteside, welcome to The Therapy Show.
Thank you. I'm so glad to be here. I'm happy to be on the show and hoping that some of the stuff you and I can talk about might be helpful to some of the people who listen to your show.
Can you start by telling us a little bit about your personal background and professional development that led you to your research on the topic of unplanned suicide attempts?
Absolutely. I am a person who discovered psychology in undergraduate and thought, oh my goodness, you can actually understand why people do the things that they do. And there are things that you can do to help make life better when people are struggling. I just threw myself completely into what's the furthest and farthest you can go in the psychology field, which is, of course, getting a PhD in clinical psychology. I moved out to the University of Washington in Seattle from Minnesota so that I could work with one of the most exciting researchers, Marsha Linehan, who developed dialectical behavior therapy. That treatment I thought was so cool because it focused on emotions. That really so central was the idea that emotions drove our behavior, and making sense of and managing and taming and harnessing emotions was really where it was at. And I loved that idea, and I still love that idea. And that eventually down the road got me to studying suicide attempts and unplanned suicide attempts and trying to understand the phenomena of a suicide attempt better, but then also the phenomena of an unplanned suicide attempt better. So I can talk a little bit about that and how it came to be that I got to interview over 25 suicide attempt survivors about their experience leading up to their moments before their attempt.
Can you tell us what's going on when you interview suicide attempt survivors?
A colleague and I, Julie Richards, submitted a grant to the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention, and thankfully they thought it was a good idea too. But we wanted to talk to people who had had a suicide attempt, but shortly before they'd seen their doctor. Their doctor had asked them, usually on a standardized questionnaire, whether they were having suicidal thoughts, just part of routine care, either primary care or mental health. We wanted to interview specifically people who said no and then made a suicide attempt. And so we're working within Kaiser, which is a really large health system. Unfortunately, there are a large number of people who attempt suicide, and you can identify them through the medical record. We started talking to these people who'd gone to their doctor when asked that they weren't suicidal, but then attempted not too long after. What they said were things that we thought they might say. They said things like, I wasn't sure what my provider would do with that information. I was afraid I would get in trouble. I was ashamed. But the vast majority of the people that I interviewed, and this is a qualitative interview, so you have to take it for what it is. The vast majority, they said that they had no plan to attempt suicide the day that they did. So they may have been having some suicidal thoughts and struggling, but they hadn't had any plans. In fact, all but one had no plans before their suicide attempt and near death. And that really got me thinking. As a psychologist, we read about this idea that sometimes people, they don't do a lot of planning before they attempt suicide. And I have to say, even though I've been working with suicidal people since 1999, I wasn't really completely convinced. But in talking to these people, what they described was the shift that they had. It was almost as if something changed in their body. It was a full body experience of a shift in how they were feeling. It didn't actually come out of the blue, per se. Something, for the most part, happened, like a relationship ended and it seemed like it was permanent, or they were going to end up going to jail or something. Something happened that was a surprise, and then there was this intense shift that they had. But it wasn't always tied to something. What they were describing was this intensity that came on, and that in a short period of time, they attempted suicide. So I really wanted to understand that better, and I wanted to incorporate the information that I had, both from the research studies that existed, but also with the patients that I serve and with my team. I have a team of people with lived experience. And also just personally, with lived experience, what I had experienced. I tried to pull those different things together to better understand this experience. And it really fit in with Marsha Linehan's work on emotions and understanding emotions. So I can talk a little bit more about that and how there might be a way to talk about what's happening here and explain it to people so that it makes more sense, if that's something that you're interested in.
Yes. One of the really cool things that came out of that research with the people who had attempted suicide and really hadn't had a plan to do that was essentially an intervention. We call it what to do if you have an overwhelming urge to suicide, if that urge comes on. We think about it much the same way that we think about fires, physical fires. So for a physical fire in an area that's a high fire risk, you can do fire prevention. You could be in a fire, so you could be in a hotel where there's a fire happening. You're in a fire. That's where fire extinguishers and 911 come in. Worst case scenario, you can be on fire physically. And we know when you're on fire physically, it's the stop, drop, and roll. That is so critical. It's very basic. It's the stop, drop, and roll. And it has to be something you know ahead of time, because if none of us were trained in stop, drop, and roll, we wouldn't know what to do if we were in a kitchen fire and our shirt caught on fire. But it's been drilled into us from when we were kids. And it turns out far more people are dying of suicide than are dying in fires. And of the people who die by suicide, we suspect a large number of them had no plans to kill themselves until shortly before their suicide. Essentially, they became on fire emotionally, but they didn't have a stop, drop, and roll. Maybe they knew of 911, but the thought did not even enter their mind to call 911, just like it wouldn't make sense to call 911 when you were on fire physically. You need a stop, drop, and roll. So I surveyed a whole bunch of people to say, what would it be? What would a stop, drop, and roll be for an emotional fire where suicidal thoughts came on the table? What we came up with was something to address that emotional intensity people were describing, where their physiology, their emotions were so hot that they could no longer think clearly. And then we came up with instructions for what not to do and for how to get to safety. And so the stop, drop, and roll currently, as informed by people with lived experience, crisis response workers, psychologists, emotion experts, is that if you have that overwhelming urge to suicide or use drugs or alcohol, and that's dangerous for you, you would shut that emotion down, shut your physiology down, and that would be with cold water or with sleep. So if you can sleep, otherwise use cold water, put your face in cold water. What we know is that rapidly changes your physiology and your emotionality. It's working with your vagal nerve or your vagus nerve and eliciting the mammalian dive response. That's your drop. You're dropping your face into cold water. There's a video on Now Matters Now under the Crisis Help tab, which is on the top right-hand corner, that describes these steps. The second step is make no important decisions, especially deciding to die. Make no important decisions. Wait 24 to 48 hours, because what we know is that
intense suicidal crises usually resolve in that period of time. But if you don't know that, you think it's going to be like this forever, it's harder to survive. But if you know, oh, this is part of it, they told me this would happen, then it seems more manageable because you know it will change, it will end. It won't be perfect, but it won't be as intense. And then the last step currently in our stop, drop, and roll for overwhelming emotional fire, for being on fire emotionally, is to make eye contact, because eye contact is a powerful pain reliever. It's also a really powerful stimuli that can help drag someone out of their emotional, internal pain and suffering and get you in the presence of another person. Step three is to find someone and ask them to get them out of their head. So, can you help me get out of my head? That ideally is in person, but that can be somebody over Messenger, you know, over video chat. That can even be a pet. For some people, it could be a photo where you're connecting with somebody's eyes, something that's more strong than the thoughts you're having, or at least strong, so that you have a fighting chance of getting outside of your brain, because it's so powerful for people who describe it. It's so all-encompassing, you need something really strong. So the stop, drop, and roll for overwhelming urges to kill oneself or to use substances when that's very dangerous is to use cold water or sleep, to make no important decisions and not panic. Last but not least, to make eye contact, to get in the presence of another being, ideally one that you trust. That really came out of the work that we did with the suicide attempt survivors to say, not only what's happening for you, but okay, now what can we do about it? We're not going to leave you hanging. We're going to come up with at least a pilot solution that we can start trying out. It's best informed. And this is what we're using right now as a guide for what to do in training people. Everyone should know what to do in an overwhelming crisis. This isn't just true for suicide and drugs. We should all know what to do when the worst happens. I think that's so important. So thanks for letting me tell you that story.
That's an incredible story. And it just proves that using the physiological interventions are very effective.
We have a lot of hope for that. We haven't really explored that. We've hit people up with large doses of medication, but I suspect that shutting your physiology down in this way is more rapid than most medications could ever be.
Suicide is one of the leading causes of death in the US and the second leading cause of death among individuals between the ages of 10 and 34. Every case is unique, but can you shed some light on what may be some of the overarching factors affecting adolescents and adults?
We in the field of suicide get asked this all the time. The truth is that we don't know. There are a lot of things that put someone at higher risk for suicide, but those same things can be present in people who do and don't attempt. That's one of the things that has really perplexed us for a long time, is really being bad at knowing who was at highest risk and being able to predict. There are things that make a lot of sense, like having a childhood filled with adverse events and trauma. There are things like serious medical conditions like bipolar disorder that increase the risk. There are things that we know increase the risk, but we're actually really bad at knowing for sure what causes it specifically. And most of the time, we think it's a whole number of factors that come together at the wrong time, the wrong place, that put someone in that heightened risk state for suicide.
And many people who have attempted suicide, maybe even completed a suicide, have never had a psychiatric diagnosis. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is true. When we look at medical charts of people who die by suicide, in big medical systems, most had never received mental health treatment, nor had they received a mental health diagnosis. For the most part, that's true that people won't necessarily be diagnosed and be receiving care. Maybe they are having depression symptoms, but they may not have ever gotten care for it. That's one of the things that we struggle with as well, is trying to get help to those that need it. I think the other thing is that it's so hard to get resources to people, especially those folks that are suicidal, because that requires specialized training and it's often quite expensive. So that's one of the problems that really been a challenge for myself and colleagues, is how to get useful information out to people who are clinicians and family members and people who are struggling and make it as accessible as possible.
Which brings me to my next question, which really relates to what you were talking about. What is NowMattersNow.org?
NowMattersNow.org is a resource. It's a website. There is both a guided version and then an online public version. So the online public version is NowMattersNow.org. And we'll talk about that in a moment. And then the guided version, Now Matters Now, is what's being tested in the really large research trial that you mentioned in my bio with 18,000 patients. We're awaiting the results on that to see whether just sharing those resources of people talking about how they use strategies from dialectical behavior therapy, people who had been suicidal themselves, if sharing those resources with people who are at greater risk for suicide, if that reduced their risk of suicide attempt. And I sure hope so, but it's a long shot. So we're waiting on the results of that big, big, big trial. In the meantime, we wanted to make everything that we created for that research study available for free to the public, because we knew that there wasn't a lot of resources out there about what's a DBT skill, and among the DBT skills, what's opposite action and how do you do it? So we created NowMattersNow.org. It's also now a nonprofit, all volunteer run. And that's where you can find a whole host of free resources, largely video-based, of people talking about how they got through intense emotions, suicidal thoughts, cravings also for substance use, using strategies from dialectical behavior therapy developed by my mentor, Marsha Linehan. There's also a free training and resources section where there is a safety plan, which is a guided plan for developing a strategy for getting through suicidal crisis or substance use crisis. And then there's just a ton of free downloadables that you can feel free to share with the people that you work with. The good news about the website is that we wanted to know from the very beginning, would this be helpful to people? And we had no idea that just whether visiting a website would be at all helpful. And the good news is that for people who visit the website and report that they're having suicidal thoughts, there are significant reductions in their suicidal thoughts as self-reported in under 10 minutes on the website. And when we started asking people, well, why is this? Why do you feel less suicidal? What people said was true for them is that they felt less alone and that they learned something. So just watching videos helped people feel less alone. And the fact that they were learning something seemed to be helpful. We've not come across another website that's been able to have similar findings or even evaluate such a thing as what we're doing.
Already you have findings?
Yeah. So those were published this past spring. We looked at different groups. In our first study, we involved middle-aged men because we know they're among the highest risk for suicide. And also we looked at whether it made a difference whether you were a mental health clinician or not. What it turned out is that the website worked well for men as well as for non-middle-aged men, but they didn't have as big of an impact as for non-middle-aged men, which means that we could probably improve the website to be a little bit more specific to men. We also saw that we have what we think is a lot of people are visiting the website and filling out the survey. So they'll say they're not having suicidal thoughts when they enter, and they're not having suicidal thoughts 10 minutes later because they're clinicians. Not that clinicians aren't suicidal, but what we found is that it looks like this survey is a good measure and it is pulling out true information because we could pull out also clinicians, which I'm sort of adding more information than I need, but that's the good findings. And then we also started, and this is unpublished but presented in Europe, we found that for teens and young adults, their suicidal intensity was rated as higher, but they had bigger reductions in their suicidal thoughts and negative emotions than non-teens, which was also quite surprising because it's not specifically geared towards youth or teens. That was very exciting. And also for suicide attempt survivors, we're starting to just add more questions. Are you this? Are you that? Because we're continuously generating data. So far, so good. We continue to be hopeful and we continue to add new videos and content to the resource.
So it sounds like it's been effective for middle-aged men and teenagers. Anyone else?
All of the populations we've looked at so far, it has been effective for. What we want to say is that we don't assume that this is a long-term impact. What we're looking and measuring is just in the short period of time, does this help? And it appears to help in the short period, which is really, really important, is how to get people through critical moments. And it's a resource that my patients have told me and do tell me that they'll go to in the middle of the night if they can't sleep, because I see largely high-risk suicidal patients or people who are really struggling. That's one of the things they find helpful and find comfort in. And I don't think that's just because of me. I think that's because there's a distraction there. There's a reminder that things can be better. You're not alone. I am hopeful that this might be something that at least in the short term could be useful.
And is it effective for someone who has not had a diagnosis and also for people who have had a diagnosis of mental disorder?
That's a great question, because we haven't broken it down yet by whether you've been diagnosed or not been diagnosed. Within that big category of people who said it was helpful, I know that big chunks will have had diagnoses and others will have not had diagnosis. And it's certainly possible that it wouldn't work for those that were diagnosed. But I don't see any evidence to suggest that yet. I think I would have seen that when I pulled out suicide attempt survivors. I might be getting too far into the weeds. I will be looking at diagnosis, but first I'm kind of looking at these larger things like, have you had a suicide attempt before? And I actually am really curious about Native American populations and LGBT, actually even before diagnostic type of labels.
What's the average length of treatment for somebody working with a Now Matters Now protocol?
That's a really good question, because it's not really a treatment per se. In the research study that is being evaluated, people got messages directing them to their resources, emails, essentially secure emails, every couple weeks to once a month. Over the course of, it just depends on how engaged, but over like 6 months or more. Don't quote me on that exactly. It kind of depends. That was in the research study. But then in real life, it's really kind of intended to be, use it as you need it. Come back and visit us. And if you're a clinician, be strategic about the way that you use it. Say, I'm teaching you opposite action this week. Let's open your phone and look at the Diana video of opposite action together. Now I'd like you to try it. And I'd like you to watch some of the other opposite action videos, and let's talk about it next time you come back. So you really use it as a tool to help support what you're doing if you're teaching dialectical behavior therapy skills. So one organization called CenterZone, they have developed a group therapy that's just based around the website. People watch the videos together. They have group skills that's focused on videos and the website itself. So people are doing all sorts of creative things, not all of which have been evaluated, but there's good reason to believe that this approach would be useful, that hearing stories of how other people survived and coped using evidence-based strategies, we have good reason to believe that that would be helpful and to try and adapt that in different settings as well.
What do people need to know about suicidal behavior?
I think what would be helpful for people to know about suicidal behavior is that it's really common in many ways. And by that, I mean, suicidal thoughts are very common. Approximately 10 million adult Americans seriously consider suicide in a given year. That's not just thoughts. And that's a large chunk of us. What that means is that a lot of us are really suffering. And at the same time, the vast majority of us will not go on to kill ourselves. The reason that's important is I think that we're really anxious about suicide. When I think if we instead came at it from the angle of, this is part of the human condition, this means somebody's really suffering, we might be able to slow down and be with somebody in a way that is much harder if we're really afraid. So it's this idea that it's part of the human condition, it's not uncommon, and it's really an indicator of pain and suffering. And people find when someone can be present with them when they're in pain, that can go a long ways. And we just weren't taught that. Nobody taught us that. No one taught us to not panic when somebody's in a lot of pain.
What do families need to know about suicidal behavior?
One of the things that I think it's helpful to know is that when somebody's getting really upset, or if they're attempting suicide, you're looking at them and you're saying, why do they have such a hard time? It's often because their biology, their history, or their just moment-to-moment experience is different than ours. You know how on one day, if you stub your toe, it's like no big deal. But on another day, if all the things have lined up the wrong way, you stub your toe and you might just stab somebody if they're standing next to you. It really depends on what state you're in, how you respond. And the same is true for the rest of us, that some of us are walking through our day-to-day lives with our stress and emotional pain level at a 40, whereas some of us are at a 20. But if you're a 20, you can't tell someone's at a 40 from looking at them on the outside. But if that person who's at a 20 was at a 40, they would understand why it was hard and why when you stub your toe, you get so upset. It's really hard to put yourself in those shoes if you're not feeling that way already. It's really hard to imagine why someone's responding the way that they are, but it actually makes sense that anybody whose baseline stress level was a 40 or a 50 and then they stub their toe, their emotion would go up more quickly, last longer, take longer to come down. But it's hard to have empathy for that when you're not having that same experience. But then if you don't know why you're so different, like say you're the person who has a really strong emotional response, then you've got all this judgment of yourself, or you have to push people away from around you because you can't make sense of the fact that you're responding in a way that they don't understand. It's just really a painful experience. But if you can say, oh, if you're the person who's struggling, oh, this makes sense. I'm in a lot of pain right now. And to acknowledge yourself, or to have a family member or friend who can say, hey, you're going through something right now and you're in a lot of pain and I'm here with you. Those small things can make a difference.
When we think about validation, Marsha Linehan always talks about validating.
Marsha Linehan is such a big proponent of validation. There's something about it. Without it, our brains cannot move forward. They get so stuck. And nobody taught us this in elementary school. It's like we're missing this really, really key thing for success in life, which is just acknowledge somebody's feelings. You don't have to say, yes, you're right, such and such is a jerk, but you can say, you're really angry right now, and I bet it feels super uncomfortable. Or I know what it's like to feel that angry. I wish you didn't have to go through this right now. That validation can just bring down the intensity of emotion, whereas judgment can pump it way up. She just talked about that so much, and I wish that we learned it when we were kids. Kids are experiencing everything for the first time. We have a hard time remembering what that was like. It's like learning to drive, but it's with their emotions. It's hard for us to make sense of it. If they're feeling so upset about something, how could that be? Whereas we can understand why it's hard to learn how to drive, right? And how confusing and upsetting it can be. But we have a harder time with emotions. It would be nice if we could bring that same empathy to teens. And I think also what's different is now in popular culture, the musicians and the artists are really talking a lot about mood and depression and suicidal thoughts and sadness in a way that was not true when I was growing up or was very different. Now you can know your artists intimately through social media. And so emotions are much more explored, but I don't know that we are offered the coping strategies to go along with them. That part is missing. And I hope we'll come down the road of like, well, and here's what you do to move on in your day after you've fully felt your emotions.
What is the best way for outpatient therapists to approach suicidal thoughts and behaviors with their clients?
One of the things I teach therapists is something called linking strategies. And it goes back to what you just talked about with validation. That on one hand, you validate and accept the person exactly where they're at. So you're saying you make sense. And I can understand why you'd be in so much pain. So you've got that on the left. You do that first. And then on the right, you don't leave that person hanging. You offer hope and you offer DBT skills, hope and change. In dialectical behavior therapy, the dialectics means two opposites can be true at the same time. That is that you can both accept where you're at and want to change at the same time.
Doesn't the dialectic include people wanting to both live and die at the same time, two dialectical experiences?
What's so interesting is that you can both want to live and want to die at the very same time, and that those can vary. So wanting to live could be, let's say, a 30 out of 100, and wanting to die could be a 90 out of 100. But over the course of that day, or one day, or a week, those could fluctuate both enormous amounts. And people don't know that. They think, well, that person doesn't really want to die because they're going to therapy. Or that person doesn't really want to live because they're not going to therapy. And it's just not that simple. Oftentimes, people feel more than one way, even after they've attempted, they still feel more than one way.
What do you think the role of social media and technology is on the increases in suicidal behavior?
Well, on one hand, I think there's so much potential for social media and technology. We're going to need it in order to reduce suicide and to impact suicide. There's enormous potential for communication and connection, sharing of information, and regular checking in. And we're just not harnessing it. We haven't figured out how to use this beast yet that has so much potential. Unfortunately, some of its worst aspects are happening, and online bullying is a real thing, even among adults. it's a hard thing to grapple with and address. And I think there are just ways to join communities, both positive and not as healthy, that you wouldn't have otherwise had the ability to find so easily. Some of our social media organizations are doing the work to help not make the platform one where people are able to be taken advantage of or bullied or be subjective to images that increase the risk of suicidal thoughts. There's a real commitment among a number of social media organizations, but it's still really new and exciting. I think the potential is so big that we need energy and attention on that and resources. And that's one of the things the field struggles with most, just like any other field, but really, especially this field, is money and the time to get a bunch of experts in the room and to have them really work things out and do it well and to spend their time in a way that's most efficient. I don't know that academia is set up for us to make maximal progress with suicide.
What are you most excited about in mental health treatment today?
We've been talking about some of the stuff I'm most excited about, which is technology and access. It's so hard for most people to get access to mental health resources, especially ones that are good and evidence-based. Therapy, thinking of rural communities and non-rural communities, the wait lists are really long. And particularly for people who don't look like us, who aren't white and middle class or above, it's not an easy endeavor. And so I'm really excited about the accessibility that is increasing with resources like the Crisis Text Line and the Suicide Prevention Lifeline. Now Matters Now, and with other tools that are underway in development that I think will help bridge some of the gaps that people have with getting access.
If you had a magic wand and could improve one thing about mental health treatment today as it relates to the topic of suicide behavior, what would that be?
There's so many great things that would be wonderful to improve. This is probably not going to be what you expect me to say, but one of the things I think is the biggest obstacle is humans and our relationships with one another. Leaders in the field getting along with one another, clinicians getting along with one another, healthcare systems taking care of their employees so that they aren't burnt out. It's very much we get in our own way of progress. I see that all the time, that so much more could happen if we could get on the same page and be practical about our efforts. Practical, I think that's what it would be. It's like, let's be pragmatic, let's be practical, let's be efficient. And let's put our attention on preventing suicide and let go of the other stuff. That's my fantasy.
So we know about nowmattersnow.org, which is your website. Any other work that you'd like to talk about?
One newer resource that I enjoy is Speaking of Suicide. And this is by some mental health clinicians who put together a resource for family members, friends of people who are struggling. And that's definitely worth checking out and seeing whether it's something you'd want to use in your clinical practice to share with people. It's called speakingofsuicide.org.
Excellent. A link to that will be on my website. So Dr. Whiteside, on behalf of myself, my listeners, and all of the people you have helped through your work, I want to thank you for your contributions to mental health treatment and for taking the time out of your busy schedule to help me and my audience better understand the field of unplanned suicide attempts and suicidal behavior.
Thank you so much for being here. And on the Now Matters Now website, under free training and resources, there's a whole host of downloadables, things that you can print for free. Please make use of. There's also free online training that you're welcome to take advantage of. So thanks again for having me.
I will definitely do that. By the way, I've already been on your website and it's phenomenal.
Definitely not perfect, but we're working on it.
It's really phenomenal. I have to say, I've been on it. I've clicked on all the pages and it's really quite a piece of advanced work. So congratulations.
Thank you.
So be sure to check out my website, www.therapyshow.com, which has many resources about mental health. There you will also find how to submit questions, stories, or insights you have about the mental health system, or suggestions about who I can interview and how I can improve the show. I'd like to close by reminding our listeners to please subscribe, share, and review this podcast so you, someone you love, and people around the world can gain more benefit from therapy. There is no need to suffer in silence. Get the help that you need to create the life that you want.